Hey, what's up, everybody? All righty. First of all, let me know where you're joining us from. We always like to know that fun stuff.
Washington State. Didn't you say I'm part of everyone?
One of those reasons, Mark. One of those reasons. Anyway, guys, we are going to share today. We're going to have a discussion about what to kind of how to handle haters. Critics. These could be, you know, online haters, people who leave nasty comments / Facebook messages. Not that that happened recently, and not that I'm gonna totally share that message, and all that fun stuff. But it could just be the critics in your life. It could be. I actually want to pull up this this post here from good old Micah. Anyway,
you should have blocked out his name and changed his name too.
Right. Michelle. Yeah. So anyway, so the inspiration for this came from a Facebook message we got on June 24th, actually. And I happened to catch it. Hey, I'm assuming it's pronounced Joachim. In Stockholm, Sweden, or as our four-year-old son calls it, Homestock. If you ask him what the capital of Sweden is, he will say Homestock. And then he'll start giggling and go, I mean, Stockholm. Anyway, so, hey, Gwen. So, yeah, so this is based on this message we got, and I'm gonna read parts of this message, because we try to keep our Facebook lives and all of our content family friendly. And he sent this message and say, hey, I'm Micah Distel, and I, comma, like everyone else on Facebook, comma, good punctuation at least, we got that going for him, don't give a rat's, do you guys have like a bleep thing about your bleep bleep ad for your bleep bleep scam? So shove it up your bleep, and I'll let you guys fill in the blanks there. But actually, I filled them in for you.
I'm like, I like the version that you had, and it seems like so, everybody else does too.
Mark, can you drop a link to that in the chat? And by the way, if you see guys, I might be going like this a lot today. I am sunburnt as all get out on my neck. And I got to be honest, my shirt is itching really bad right now. And so I was like, you know, I have to post this. And so I said, I posted on Facebook and said, I think that Micah might have some anger issues. He sent this lovely message. We cleaned it up a bit due to language, but I think our edits remain true to the spirit of the message. Smiley face. Poor guy is definitely stuck in a limited mindset to think that starting an affiliate program is a scam. More than 5,000 people disagree and are using our report, your first 100 affiliates, to start, build, and grow their affiliate program. I then say, you can get a copy here if you haven't yet, which, by the way, is mattmcwilliams.com/ first 100, just spell the word first in 100. And if you probably like Micah can't spell the word first, you're out of luck there. They're using it to escape. Little dig. Sometimes that's what you do with haters. They are using it to escape jobs they hate, bosses that suck, scale their businesses, and change the world. If that is a scam, then call me a scammer. Now, excuse me while I go shove a copy of my super fulfilling report right up my alligator. Because I edited this, I took a screenshot of it and edited it, said, hi, I'm Micah Distel, and I, comma, like everyone, I kept a good punctuation. So, you know, good job.
Everybody. Got that going for you.
Yeah, like everyone else on Facebook. I mean, who uses good punctuation on social media? Seriously? If you use proper punctuation on social media, that's all I need to know about you. And anyway, don't give a rat's arm about your super fun ad for your super fulfilling scam. So shove it up your alligator. And I love
that's the best part.
I love Michael Ray, poor alligator. Michael Ray, that was awesome. So it just reminded me that, you know, haters are real, guys. To me, we're all going to deal with haters at some point. And I'll share this encouraging word with you. Haters and critics are a sign you're doing something right. They're a sign that you're actually doing something right. And so we're just going to have a discussion about that today. You know, there's no like set agenda or anything we're going to cover. I'll just share from, like, for me, haters have ranged from, I've shared this story publicly. Hi, Mom. I love you. You're not on right now that I know of. That'd be weird. But I'm just prefacing this by the fact that I love my mom, but I've shared this story and she knows that I've shared it and she's cool with this. But I remember one day when I was starting, I think it was my second business. This is a business that ended up growing to about $18 million a year in revenue. We were one of the largest companies in a very competitive niche. It's the company, you know, when you hear me talk about that, I started with nothing and built the $12.5 million affiliate program. That's the company. But at the time that I was sitting in my mom's living room, right next to the fold-out couch that I slept every night on, you know, the kind that has like the springs that come up where you have to like sleep in the shape of an S to get around like the springs that are coming up. I mean, this couch, I seriously think it was like my mom got it from Jimmy Carter's first Habitat for Humanity house. It was that old. You know, but I was sleeping on it and I was thankful. You know, I lived with my mom. I paid her like $200 a month. You know, that was all I could afford. I was literally making less than $1,000 a month starting this business. And I was the only one in the business that made any money. And I'm sitting there one day, it was probably about 7 o'clock. I remember specifically that it was during the winter. So it was already dark outside. I've been working since before she left for work. I think I took about a half hour in the middle of the day to walk the dog, just get outside, get some fresh air. Otherwise, I had been just in front of the computer working my face off. And she was like, what are you doing? You know, like, you've been working all day and you're probably going to work till midnight. You know, I'm like, yeah, if I decide to take off early. And and she was like, what are you doing? Like, that's ridiculous. Like, you didn't even make any money. And I was like, well, Mom, you know, we're getting this thing started. You know, I was 25, you know, I was 24 actually at the time. I didn't have a family. I didn't have any relationships. I didn't care. Like, all I could do is work. And I said, that's what it takes. You know, like, I'm going to work before most people even wake up, and I'm going to work after they go to bed. She's like, well, sure doesn't seem like you're very successful to me. She's like, ouch.
Wow. Thanks, Mom.
Yeah.
Love you too.
Yeah.
That's encouraging.
Yeah. For a moment that hurt, but really all it did was just kind of drive me even harder in that moment. You know, and again, 3 years later, she was attending an awards ceremony. Mark, maybe you guys have seen it. There's a Facebook ad that we run. Mark, I think you know the one. Robbie, you might as well. If you know this ad, awesome. Let us know.
Matt with a goatee.
And it's me and my two business partners holding, it's a gold record. The Nashville Business Journal, for all of Middle Tennessee, we were their top company under 25 employees at that time. And their award for that was a gold record because, you know, it's Nashville. So everything's a record, you
know, or guitar. So. Can you bring back the goatee, by the way?
Tara won't let me. And also it itches.
Robbie, does it itch?
You didn't get it long enough.
That's true. Yeah, yeah. That's the problem.
Man, yours is coming in really well after you shaved it there. I'm excited because as a representative of our company,
don't be hating on my clean shaven face.
I gotta be honest, I do kind of hate your clean shaven face.
Wow, thanks, man.
Yeah, as a representative of the company, I really don't want you looking like you're 14. And for those of you who haven't seen Robbie clean shaven, he looks like he's 14.
Go back into the
which is an improvement archives. Over me.
Which is an improvement over like, you. Well. Speaking of haters, the guy last week that came on and said, "Wow, Mark's ugly." What is it? He said he looks like Kylo got hit with an ugly stick or something. I don't remember what it was. Yeah. I was like,
I don't remember. So dang. Here's the funny thing. Here's the funny thing about that. The thing that offended me most about that was the Kylo comment, not the ugly part. Just being honest.
And I think the thing to realize, you know, before we kind of just dive into this discussion, we'll share some other examples, is like, to me, I think that Barry Friedman said it best, Mark. I don't know if you remember this, but he said that when he said that haters basically are, you know, or critics that have no reason being a critic. First of all, I'm going to get way off track here, but I love the Morgan Freeman quote that says, I never accept criticism from someone whom I wouldn't accept advice from. And like,
I think you should have said that in a Morgan Freeman voice.
I just tried a little bit there. Where's Frank Caliendo when you need him?
Or I know, right?
Morgan Freeman when you need him, right?
Right.
This morning, we invited you to this Facebook Live, just asked you for a quick cameo, and then you're busy or something. What are you busy doing? You're like, there's nothing like you're on set right now. Anyway, talking to him like we actually invited him. Anyway, but no, I mean, and that is kind of the standard, just by the way, is like, I don't accept criticism. I don't accept, I really don't accept anything from someone whom I'm not willing to accept advice from. That's that level where it's like, if you're going to, you know, offer criticism, you're going to offer, you know, throw some shade or whatever. You got to be you got to be at the level where I would like actually accept advice from you. And that doesn't mean you have to be like, quote unquote, as successful. That's not where I'm like, I accept advice from a lot of people who I appreciate that maybe aren't as successful in a certain area of life as me. And then they're way more successful in other areas of life. But anyway, but Barry Friedman said, if I remember correctly, basically said that haters, when they hate on you, when they leave a negative comment on your YouTube video and call you ugly or say that you look like Kai Lu. This is especially true for women. Like I gotta be honest. That's the first time I've ever once in the history of social media seen a man call another man ugly, which is saying something. Now, men will call women ugly.
What are you saying that it says?
Women will call women ugly, and that's just, it's like a dark side of YouTube. I have a friend, Crystal Payne, that just, I remember one time she wrote to me and was just like, yeah, things have just been so nasty lately. Like, really? That actually happens? You know, does that actually happen? That's just insane to me that they would go on there and just be like, you know, you look like this. And I'm like, okay, I mean, what's the point of that? It's a reflection on them. And what they're saying, when he sees this ad, I don't know where he's at in life. My guess is he wishes he was running ads. He wishes he had his own business. He wishes he could do the same thing, and he's not. And so he's projecting his negative feelings about himself and his situation on those who are taking action. And so, like I said, it's a sign that you're doing something right, is kind of my opinion, because I don't know about you guys, but I don't hate on people who aren't on my radar, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I don't hate on anybody personally, but that's not true.
Well, that's good.
I won't say who. No, I'm just kidding.
Me?
Yeah. Shut up, Kai Lu.
No, I think that's the, well, first off, I want to say that I think that's the longest anybody's ever taken to share a one line thing that Barry Friedman talked about. Long story short. Yeah. That was like 8 minutes. That was like 8 minutes to get to the punchline.
Why does my Morgan Freeman voice sound like Sean Connery? I should have done it in my Morgan Freeman voice. I don't even know who is that. Sounds like the pirate from the Lego movies.
But I mean, I think, you know, you hit on exactly, you know, sharing what Barry said, you hit on exactly what I always remind myself when we deal with those people, is it probably has nothing to do, honestly, with you. You know, I think a lot of times what I've realized is there's something else going on in their life that is just, you know, and we don't know. Like, I don't know what it is. And, you know, you referenced the conversation. No, you didn't. We had another one recently, and I was tempted to be kind of snarky at first. And I think that's fairly typical. And I gotta be honest, one of the best ways I handle haters like that is be snarky internally, either to myself or, you know, to the team. And then I go back and I say something nicer. And then I went from snarky to, okay, I'm just going to be brutally honest with this person.
Yeah.
And then I went to, okay, I'm going to be polite and kind and kind of take the high road. And I didn't think of it as take the high road, because I feel like saying you're taking the high road is kind of arrogant. It was just that, hey, I'm going to try to be, you know, provide good customer service. And this person, when I did that, they came back and Robbie, would you say it was more vitriol than the first one? I mean, it got worse.
More aggressive than the first email.
No,
and then it got worse again.
But I want to set this up, because this person applied for our program. It's called Your Affiliate Launch Coach.
Applied for a consult.
Yeah, for a consult. Sorry.
Free call.
Free coaching call.
Applied. Now,
when you apply for this, we don't accept everyone even to get a coaching call just because of, you know, we want people to be in a time, but we want people to be in a certain place, right. You know, before we do it. And maybe you were going to say this, Mark, but I just want to point out that you, like, I read your response because we looked at this, like, you know, as the leader of the company, I do want to look at these things and say, okay, did Mark handle this as best as he could? Is there any feedback I could give him? And the truth is there's not, you know, in fact, I think I complimented you on it and said, wow, you know, that was a perfect response because we responded or you responded and offered, like you said, hey, we're not going to do the coaching call. Right now you're not a good fit for the program based on your application. And you said something to the effect of, if you think that that's not the case, if you feel like we've judged this wrong, please let me know. In the meantime, here are like four other resources that will help you, that if you go engage with that content, implement what we teach in that content, very quickly, you will become eligible for this, you know, for this free coaching call. It's like, that's amazing customer service, if you ask me. So continue, Mark, because I just wanted to kind of set that up there real quick.
Yeah, I mean, we try to do that with anybody that we don't schedule a call with, is give them the next step. Because, I mean, and I think this is where, you know, when you're dealing with, you know, in customer service in general, but especially people that are upset about something, you know, I recognize, you know, it's like when I'm doing those calls, I can't do a million of them. And like mm-hmm. you said, it's not going to benefit you to get on a call with me if what I'm going to tell you is exactly what you could get in this other free resource. I mean, it's just not going to benefit you. So that's the reason that, yeah, we declined it. And then they came back with, you know, and exactly what I said, like I found out from their response that it really had nothing to do with us. Like there was a lot of other things going on in this person's life. And unfortunately they directed it back at us and blamed us for those things and said that that was the reason. But when the response came, I have to admit, I was really, really glad that I responded the way I did, because I was never going to send a snarky comment. I was never going to send a snarky remark. I just wasn't, you know. I kind of subscribed to the Mark Twain thing, you know, where it's like he would write a mean letter and give it to his wife to mail, and his wife would file it away in a cabinet or throw it away. You know, it's like, and he felt better and they never had to hear anything about it. And that's great. So I was never going to send a snarky response, but I did seriously contemplate just being brutally honest and saying, hey, look, you know, here it is. Like, you know, I don't really appreciate the way you came back, but if you want to know, here it is. And I'm glad I didn't, because if I had, I see the way the conversation would have went, and it wouldn't have been a good, it wouldn't have reflected good on us, even though I wouldn't have said anything wrong necessarily. But I think if I had sent that brutally honest response, I think it would have been because I forgot that there's probably things going on in somebody's life when they respond in a certain way. That has nothing to do with us. And it would have made my second response a lot more difficult if I had responded my initial way. And I think, you know, for me, one of the best ways to deal with haters is I thought about that response for a couple hours. I didn't send the first response I thought of. I didn't send the second response I thought of, because typically those are emotional and it doesn't go well. And I would have been totally in the right. And I don't think I would have done anything wrong. And I'm pretty sure both of those response, well, maybe not the snarky one. You probably would have said, hey, don't do that. But the brutally honest response. Yeah.
But, I mean, did laugh first response, when I saw that. I got the text message on that one. I was like, yeah, that's funny. Don't do that.
Yeah. But I mean, the brutally honest response, I'm pretty confident, Matt, you would have said, yeah, that I'm cool with that. But I still don't think it was the right response. And so dealing with people like this, I think it's important to take some time, not always just fire off your first response, because, you know, it does reflect. And I think sometimes they're not going to care and they're just going to be annoyed and ticked off, and that's fine. Other times I think they may look back later and say, you know what, honestly, yeah, they were right, you know. And I think that's important.
And can
to
I jump in on that, Mark?
No.
Okay. I've worked customer service online for some companies that, you know, people watching this live have definitely heard of. Yeah. And what I've found is that those haters, you know, is when they come at you, a lot of times there's just a misunderstanding of what the offering is. Mm-hmm. how to access it. And so what I found is you've got to have like a structure to your, you know, your responses to these haters. You know, first acknowledge what they're feeling. Like, yeah, I'm sorry you're frustrated. That must be really difficult that you're experiencing this, you know, insert the feeling here. And then, you know, then you give your explanation. You offer additional value, and then you sum it up and say, hey, how else can we help you? And what I found in doing that basic formula there is that people, when they respond back a lot of times, if they respond back more aggressively, then you can deal with that, you know, how Mark just talked about. But a lot of times that in and of itself will turn people around, and then those people end up becoming your biggest fans because you took the time to actually engage with them, to understand them as a person, which is really at the end of the day what they're looking for. They're just looking for some real human connection.
Yeah. So Mark, I got a couple of takeaways from what you shared. Number one, you know, take the high road, even when that part of you is screaming. But I want to be snarky, because I mean, let's be honest. Like, I'm listening to a book right now called Brainwash by Dr. Perlmutter, David Perlmutter and his son, something Perlmutter, and
Junior.
And you know, one thing that he talks about, I think we all know this instinctively, is like the dopamine hit that we get from firing off the snarky reply, especially to political, you know, commentary and things like that. It feels good in the moment. It really does. And it's really easy on a phone. It's really easy on a computer to do that. And you just have to kind of ask yourself, would you do that with your significant other?
Yeah.
Would you do it even with, like, we get into, I can get into a political debate with in-laws and family members and disagree, but I don't talk like I would on social media. I try to share, you know, I'm in this family, you know, I'm talking to them like they're people that I love because I do. And so I'm wondering, you know, I got a text from my wife asking, what did you get from Neiman Marcus? I have no idea. Somebody sent me something cool. I've never shopped at Neiman Marcus in my whole life, actually. But anyway, I hear they have a great return policy and their customer service is amazing. And man, if you go in, like, dead serious, like if you go in and you like hate, like offer hate, and like you go in with like, if I went in with this book and said, this book is actually a great book, by the way, I interviewed Mike and it comes out like tomorrow. So you should listen to that podcast episode. See how that worked out? Well, that was cool. That's called an unplanned segue, y'all. But like, if I went in with this book and said, this book sucks, can't believe you guys sold this to me, like, yeah, you bought that on Amazon, they'll still take it. This is a side note. So anyway, thank you for that text, sweetheart. That was cool. Led to a great conversation there. Where was I, guys? So take the high road. Something else I said that was probably really good. Don't remember.
Squirrel.
I see that, Gwen. That's awesome. And you know, anyway, so all that to say, you know, take the high road and suggest next steps for them. I was talking about dopamine. That's right. It feels really good to do that stuff. You have to decide what you want more. Do you want the dopamine hit, or do you want to build a business that lasts? That's the decision. I mean, it's, I hate to compare the two, but it's no different than deciding, do you want the hit from the drug, or do you want your brain to function when you're 70? You know? I mean, like, that's the choice you're making. You know, I mean, that's the choice you're making. It really is, because there's actually, and Gwen, you might know more about this than I do, because you know, I'm an amateur at this stuff and I've listened to a total of two books about it. But like, we get into this thing where, so the way the psychology works is like we fire off the snarky comment and it's like rush of dopamine. We quickly come down from that. And so now we're actually below where we were. That's how drugs actually work, is my understanding, is when you come down off the high, you go lower than what your baseline is, and your baseline continues to go down, down, down. So now you need the drug just to get you back up to baseline at some point. And so social media is the same way. Like and we're doing this on social media. There's nothing wrong with social media.
I'm talking about we talk on Facebook.
Yeah, I'm talking specifically dealing with haters. You come down, and now what are you doing? You're thinking about, ooh, did somebody reply? Did they reply? And you mm-hmm. go back, and you actually get the dopamine hit just checking, but it's lower than what you were expecting or what you were hoping for. So now the disappointment sets in, and it really is a vicious cycle. And so Perlmutter talks about that, like the pleasure stress cycle, the dopamine cortisol cycle. It's actually fascinating stuff. And I think that dealing with haters kind of is the same thing. So that was like a 4-minute endorsement of the book, Brainwashed by David Perlmutter and the other guy whose last name is Perlmutter.
I'm like, I don't even know where you started with that.
Take time. Like, honestly, if you fire off the first thing that comes to mind, it's probably not the right thing. The other thing I think is, Mark, if I'm not mistaken, we have, as Michael Hyatt would say, we have a template. or as most people say, template. Just picking on Michael there. See, I'm not hating on him, though. I love him. We have a template response. So when you have a template, it makes it a lot easier to go copy, paste, send. This is the template than it does to write that from your heart, because your heart's saying you're a moron.
So to go back to the pause, though, I got to talk about this for a second.
Go back to the pause, like deep breaths.
Take a deep breath. I will tell you, I taught seventh graders for 10 years, 13 years.
All of life lessons can be
taken. Not just that, but I taught them geography. Okay, try and get seventh graders, 13 year olds excited about geography. They would say some crazy things, and they always teased me because I'd always have a coffee cup in my hand, and every time they'd ask me a ridiculous question, and I would just be like and they're like, there's Mr. Miles taking his tactical sip again. Like, it was just a tactical sip. So they all teased me constantly that I was tactical sipping. My kids now accuse me of it.
Tactically sipping or tactical sipping?
It's in the military, we call it a tactical pause. Like, you're pausing to get a full awareness of the situation. For me, it was pausing before I said something really stupid to a 13-year-old, because that never is going to go well. And but it's the same before you fire off the text message, before you send the email, before you just straight up say whatever's about, you know, imagine you've got the coffee cup. Just pause long enough to enjoy your coffee and then respond. So
I hereby add the term tactical sip to the lexicon of Matt McWilliams consulting language. We will now be recognizing Robbie's tactical sips.
All right. I want to comment on Gwen's comment there, actually, because that's something we were going to talk about. The pleasure stress cycle gets bad enough that I just started deleting and blocking the haters. But yes, I mean, that's the number one tip. I prefer the dopamine hit. Maybe I need my VA to delete them before I see them, because they bum me out and affect me for a few days rather than a moment. I've got pretty tough skin on that stuff. When I specifically told, you know, my team, I don't want to see the negative stuff. Yeah. Now, I think there's a line, like, you know, there's a line with when it reaches into absurdity. Like Micah's comment, I was glad I saw it, because the comment was so absurd.
It's great content too.
And let's talk, you know, we got tactical sips, so let's give some practical advice. Practical advice number one is use it. You know, when you can, use the negativity, use the haters' comments. You know, we know people, I won't mention like Tom Wood's name or anybody, but we know people who are really good at that. I'm trying to think who else is really good.
He does so well with it too. It's just artful.
If you guys know anyone who's really good at taking haters and then actually using them to create content, just drop a note there. If you have any examples, that'd be great. Because I I think it's great content. I mean, and then we turned it into an ad. I don't know how successful the ad's been because it's pretty early, but like it works. Practical tip number two is leave them, you know, leave them. I mean, if Gwen said something about family there, let me pull that back up. Move 2,000 miles. Yeah. I mean, you know, what do you do if your haters are your family? You leave them and, that's how you deal with negative people.
I think that, or you can prepare for
Mark, I gotta read Mark's text message unless it's because I think that's funny.
No, it's personal, it's internal. No.
I mean, guys, like, I think, you know, I mean, I even think just like, what's the scripture that's like, I always remember this one. I think there's one in the book of Matthew and there's one in the book of Acts, and they're very similar where it's like, Jesus is telling the apostles, if people aren't going to listen to you, or if they're at least not going to just welcome you, then he said, just leave the town. And he actually told them, this was the thing. He said, shake the dust off your feet. And I remember going, when I first read that, I was like, that's weird. And then I realized like what he was saying is get every remnant, like even off the bottom of your shoes, the dirtiest part of your entire being. He was like, Shane, like get the dust from, like you don't even want like a remnant of the dust of that town on your feet. That's how like just no. And we're going, okay, that's how you deal with, you know, that's how you deal with haters, whether they're family members or a follower online or you know, whatever. I mean,
yeah,
how you deal with them, Gwen. So I love it.
I think it's also important, especially if you talk social media and stuff, to remember that, you know, this is your space. Would you let somebody come into your house and treat you that way? If not, then you have full right to kick them off your lawn, you know?
Yeah, I've totally kicked people off my lawn.
Yeah, I guess my old man is showing today.
I just did my Morgan.
Need my tactical sips and get off my lawn.
Why is it every time I imitate an old man, I go like this? Is there any legitimate reason for this?
Has anyone ever seen an old man actually do this?
Am I Popeye? What am I?
Get off my lawn.
Oh, yeah, that just reminded me of this comedian. I know we're going to go way down that rabbit trail. When he's like, have I ever shared with you my Popeye impersonation, a Billy Joel impersonation? And he's like, who needs a house in Hackensack? And he's like, now let me share with you my Justin Bieber combined with Darth Vader impersonation. Who needs a house in Hackensack? He's like, oh, sorry. I think I gave you the wrong impression.
That was a good one. You did it both times.
I don't know. Do I do that every time I impersonate anyone?
I think
you
so.
Do.
No. Yeah, a lot. Fairly often. I'm trying to think of the other one that you do it fairly often on. There's one that you do.
I am your father.
No, Robbie, I think you're exactly right. You know, this isn't in an online business, and I know that's specifically what we're talking about, but my in-laws own a restaurant, and I don't know if there's a type of business in the world that gets more haters than restaurants. It's ridiculous. And, you know, exactly what you said, Robbie, there are times where people will post on their Facebook page and just say things that are ridiculous. And my wife manages their Facebook page and she's like, this just really upsets me. I'm like, delete it. I go, that Facebook page is yours. Like, it's the businesses. Mm-hmm. You don't have to allow them to put that there. And I think it's the same thing. I think sometimes you just have to say, yeah, we're not doing this. And, you know, Matt, I think you've been really good at this. And I think, you know, there's been times where I think you have stepped in when somebody's, you know, really railed on like me or on your assistant or somebody. And I think that's important too, to say is when we're talking about dealing with haters and ignoring them and those types of things, we're not saying let them walk all over you. Like it's not a matter of, you know, because this is something that I keep reminding my wife and my mother-in-law. It's like, look, the customer isn't always right. They're really not. Like there are times where people are just 100% out of line and you just have to say, look, you're out of line and we're not doing this. And I think sometimes you have to do that. Like you can be kind and you can be courteous, but I think you also have to say, no, this is the way it is. Because sometimes it really is something where they're just railing and railing and railing and they're just off base. And it's not a matter of being nice and, you know, letting them just keep attacking and keep attacking, you know, exactly what you said, Robbie, block them. You know, I mean, if they're going to be posting stuff on your social media, if they're going to be, you know, going after your team, like that's the time where you just say, no, this is done. We're not doing this, because that's just, it's ridiculous. So I don't want anybody to get the impression, I don't think you did, but I want you to get the impression that we're just saying, oh, be really nice and kind and let them just keep yelling at you. No, you don't have to do that either.
No, I mean, to me, it's do everything you can to de-escalate. And do nothing to escalate. Sometimes to de-escalate, all you have to do is just block people. Like, that really is the simplest way. I mean, I don't know how many people I've blocked on Twitter. It's probably less than 40, you know, but
just block. Is that why I don't see your tweets anymore? Totally kidding.
I didn't say you blocked me. No, I mean, like, it's block them. It's remove them from your email list. Set up a filter in your email that they, when they email, it goes to the deleted folder. You know, I remember years ago, so there's a guy, this is back in 2011, 9 years ago. And I had a former business partner that I went back and actually worked for the company for about 8 months. And the company was really struggling. They asked me to come back and I did. And, you know, a very, very long story, laid off about half the company. I was one of them. I went to work about 60 days later for a competitor. You know, I didn't have an NDA. I had an NDA, but I didn't have a non-compete. And, I went to work for a competitor because they asked me to come work for them. They were a client. They weren't, I told the story before, but that's how I kind of got into consulting back then. Was I had like 4 or 5 job offers, couldn't decide which one to take. So I took all of them and, you know, became a consultant. But this guy wrote an email and it's something to the effect of like, you know, you're lazy, you're incompetent, you know, question, like you're unfocused. Which reminds me, I want to talk about something. No, I'm just kidding. Question my integrity, you know, for going to work for this company. And I deleted it, but I didn't delete it. It sat in my trash, which at that time, it didn't auto-delete every 30 days. And so from time to time, I would pull up this email and I would read it, like, I don't know, every couple of weeks. And it was almost like looking at, it was like weird. It was like looking at a photo of an ex-girlfriend and like, you know, who treated you like crap, or an ex-boyfriend who treated you like crap, but somehow longing for that. It was really weird. I know there's like some sort of like deep psychological reason for that, but I thought I was using it for motivation. I actually thought that I was using it to be like, no, you know what? I'm going to like, that's not who I am. Over time, though, the words began to sink in, and I'm thinking, like, maybe I am lazy, maybe I am unfocused, maybe I never will amount to more than when I was working for him. Maybe this business is going to fail. Maybe I don't have integrity, you know. And so, what would happen when I would hear those words? Like, they were back here, they were implanted in my brain. And so, if I slept in one morning, maybe because I got in late the night before from a, you know, like we did last night, we went to bed late because we had kids soccer. Like, you know, the voices would whisper like, you're lazy, you know, like, see, you hit the snooze button. And if you were worth anything, you would have been up an hour ago. And then I remember the day that it finally occurred to me that I could, as we talked about earlier, I could shake the dust off my feet. And I permanently deleted that email. From that point forward, those thoughts, like, you know, a month later, they were gone. Like, I never thought those things again. And I think whether it's, real people, social media, email, whatever, that's the best way. Like, you don't have to, I never told him, I never responded to the email. I haven't talked to him since, you know. Do anything you can to de-escalate. If you can't de-escalate, then just let it be. It's probably the best thing I would say is like the best de-escalator of all time. I don't know if you guys would agree with this. I think the best de-escalator of all time, especially with our short attention spans now, is 15 minutes. It's just time. Like,
yeah.
I don't know about you guys, but I sent about 30 emails this morning. I couldn't name 5 of them. So, I mean, I've already forgotten 25 of the 30 emails I sent. And so, and I probably forgot them about 15 minutes after I sent them. And so the best de-escalator is just time. So, you know, if it's really bad, yeah, remove them. You know, go in, if you use ConvertKit, you go in and you click a little, it's like, a little trash can icon, confirm it, boom. They don't get your emails anymore, so they can't reply. Simple as that.
Yeah.
And then I usually I'll set up a filter too that just automatically deletes their emails. And maybe they sent a response, you know, later that day and said, I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have sent that email earlier. Well, didn't see it.
I don't even know that. Yep.
Too bad.
Yeah. I think there's I referee soccer, and there's another industry that gets a little bit of haters. Referees of any sort, actually.
Oh, but, man. I got out the other day. Not really.
Jeez, Matt. But there's a referee that I officiate with sometimes, and he has the best response. Like when people come up to him and start screaming at him or complaining or telling me he did something wrong, he literally, I've seen him do it. He looks at them and he goes, oh, thanks for sharing that. And then he turns around and walks away. He's just like, done. You know, it's like, but it stops people because they're like, they're expecting, like you said, they're expecting you to escalate. They want you to respond. They want you to yell at them. They want you to argue. And so the minute he just says, oh, okay, thanks for sharing that, they're just like, they stop like, wait, where do I go now? Like, no, you're supposed to argue with me. It's like, no, I don't need to. And so I think that's a valid thing. I think that idea, like you said, Matt, of de-escalating or at least not escalating, I think is a big point because that's what people are. I mean, they want to feel validated by proving their point or arguing their point. And it really doesn't do anything. Mm-hmm. The other thing I thought of too, Matt, is, and I thought maybe this was the story you were going to share, but responding to these correctly is important because sometimes, like we said, it's not you, it's something else going on in their life. And that actually may come back and be a good relationship at some point. You know, they may come back and they may be a customer. They may follow you. They may realize that, you know, they were dealing with some stuff and they responded poorly. You know, Matt, you had a person when I first started working with you, and you'll know who I'm talking about, that sent a pretty scathing email. Pretty scathing email.
Yeah, I know.
And it was a conversation in our company for a couple of weeks. And from then until about, I don't know, last fall. Well,
his name became a euphemism for...
Yeah. Yeah.
Something else.
A jerk. Yeah. It's like, so for probably what, Matt, 4 years, people would mention this person. And it's somebody that a lot of people have heard of.
We like spoke at the same event once and, you know.
And it was like people would all be like, oh, I love this person. This person's awesome. Like he would have testimonies for people. And Matt and I are always just like, that guy's a jerk. Like he's a jerk and we don't want anything to do with him. And then you ended up at the same event with him, ran into him and talked to him. And you're like, dude, I love that guy. Like, and now you guys, you know, have a great relationship and it's probably going to be really valuable. And it could have gone differently, I think, we probably held on to it longer than we should have anyways, but depending how you responded to me or initially, and I remember seeing your responses, like you were very professional. You're like, look, dude, this is what happened. And I'm sorry you feel that way. And it could have gone very differently. You know, and so I think it's important for us. We still heard you, Matt, even though you turned off your mic. That was funny.
really?
Yes. I've noticed that with the ATR sometimes. It still picks up stuff. But I think it's important to realize that when you respond politely, it could come back and benefit you later on. You know, those people could come back later and become a customer or become a client or speak highly of you. I mean, maybe you never interact with them. Maybe you have a filter and you never see their emails again, but you find out from somebody later on that they said, you know what, the way he responded was great. You know, I was a jerk. I was really frustrated. I just lost my job or this was happening or this was happening. And it really has nothing to do with you. And so if you respond correctly, it could turn out to be a good relationship later because, you know, and that's what I thought of when you were sharing that other story. I was like, oh, Matt's going to share this one. And then you didn't. So I wanted to share.
Yeah, I totally forgot about that.
Because it was, I mean, this was probably, I mean, that person was on a list of what, probably 3 people that we had interacted with that were in a, What's the term for that list? They who shall not be named.
Yeah.
I think usually is the way we frame it. And that person has removed themselves from that list now, which is really cool. There's still a couple others.
We shall not name
him. And we will not name
them internally. I think that the last thing I would share specifically as it pertains to marketing is this isn't about really how to deal with haters. It's how to deal with stuff that maybe you don't like. Maybe you don't like somebody's marketing style. Maybe you don't like somebody's ads, whatever. I would just encourage you not to be a critic. Don't be a hater, be a student. You know, Mark, you and I were talking about the other day. I put an ad blocker on Chrome a while back for a reason, and I don't remember what it was. And then it occurred to me about a month ago how dumb that was, because I need to be seeing it. And like, it doesn't block all ads. It just blocks some ads. Like, and I'm like, oh no, I hear people all the time. They're like, oh my gosh, it's so frustrating. I have to sit through a 5-second ad on YouTube before I watch this video for free of the exact song I selected in real time. You know, like it's sending a signal to space and back and coming all the way to, this is my magic rectangle. Dude, you're listening to the song you chose or watching the, like, you know, hour speech that you chose, and you have to sit and you wait for the skip ad. I stopped clicking the skip ad button. I look at it and it's like, oh, 12 minutes. Yeah, I'm gonna skip ad on that, you know, because that's a little too long. Like, I'm a student of marketing.
Yeah.
I'm a student of marketing. I don't get frustrated by the ads. I want to study them. And, you know, there are a few exceptions. Like if I'm listening to songs and the kids are around, I will skip ads that I know that the person, you know, frequently uses profanity. That's not why I'm skipping. I mean, that is why I'm skipping it. That's, you know, I'm not skipping it because I don't want to see the ad. I'm skipping it because I've got my 4-9-year-old with me, you know. But other than that, yeah, don't skip ads and don't get frustrated by the way people market. If somebody sends an email you don't like, don't criticize them. Study it. You know, maybe study it from the fact that you don't want to write like that. That's cool. But maybe, you know, let me just study it. Maybe there's something you can glean from that email about the way they did it. And so I know I did a podcast episode, I don't know, a year or so, 2 years ago, so don't be a critic, become a student. You know, it's one of the funniest things sometimes. We're like, yeah, I can't stand that guy. Oh, I see his ads all the time. Don't you want to be the person who people say that about? Like, do you think that that guy's running or that lady's running ads unprofitably? No, you see their ads all the time, and then you look them up and you find out they're running $100 million business. Maybe you can learn something from them. And yeah, maybe they're over the top. Maybe their ads are a little annoying. Maybe, I don't know, maybe they just learned that from their mentor, you know? so, well, inside joke there, sorry.
That was awesome. Oh, I totally wasn't expecting it. That's why it was so funny. If I would have been drinking something, it would have spit everywhere.
Can you find that video and post it?
Probably. I don't know if it's online anymore or not.
It is. I watched it when I was down in Florida with so it's from our friend Chandler Bolt. I got a podcast coming out with him pretty soon as well.
Oh, I like Chandler. Hey, Chandler Bolt here.
Yeah, anyway, so yeah, I was down in Florida at Rich Sheffern's event, and Mike Long was there, and we were talking about Chandler for some reason. I was like, dude, you got to see this video, and it's Chandler doing, it's called Chandler.
Is it on YouTube?
I think so, yeah.
All right, I'm looking.
It might be on Facebook. You're going to look it up.
Yeah. Chandler Lopez.
It's pretty funny. So we'll drop the link. You guys can get it. It looks like a 2-3-minute video. And mentor.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Books. Knowledge.
See, now I just want to watch this instead of listening to you in the episode.
As soon as this is over, I'm watching this video.
Oh yeah, so, I'm gonna go watch it too. It is on YouTube.
Reach out to Chandler and tell him that you guys watched.
It is the greatest thing ever.
And that you got it from me, and tell them you love it because it's pretty stinking awesome. Yeah. Any last thoughts, guys, as we wrap up?
Anything from you, Robbie? I'll let you go first. Oh, Robbie's got a tactical sip. What I text, by the way, I thought Matt was going to say this.
And can I just say, this is not a cool tactical sip.
I know, you have to have a...
You got to have a cup with a handle. Cup.
Like, because it's got the thin thing, I'm like sticking it into my mouth. Like...
Do you have to like slowly raise it to your mouth too? Is that part of the
tactical exactly, sip? Exactly, yeah.
Okay. All right.
And you have to peer over it too. You have to make eye contact with the person. Like, you know, it has to be this number. Like, you have to actually make... There's, like, dust on this.
Well, I thought Matt was going to be like, there's actually something in there. I guess there is dust, but that's how often Matt uses a cup.
That specific one is for display only. I should put a sticker on it that says...
For display only. Oh,
man. Yeah.
So Matt, you didn't share what you said you were going to share earlier. So I'll do it. The text I sent Matt that he said he was going to share was, I said, at some point we're going to name a Facebook Live tactical sips and practical advice. I just think that'd be great. That'd be a really good conversation one again. But no, I think the last thing I was going to say is it's a little bit different, but everything we talked about today, I think is super valuable just in general. With the way the world is right now. I mean, if you look anywhere, it's like everybody's screaming at each other and yelling at each other. It's like, dude, you don't have to respond. It's okay. Like, you can just completely ignore somebody's comment. It's cool. And can I share this? I saw this. You guys all know the Serenity Prayer, right? Like, we've heard of this.
Yeah.
I saw the greatest version, and you might have seen it on my Facebook. I don't know. I shared it. God grant me the serenity to scroll past the opinions I cannot change, courage to not comment on the things I disagree with, and wisdom to know when to snooze someone for 30 days. And I'm like, that's awesome. But I mean, it's true. Like, you don't have to respond. You don't have, I mean, what I found with haters is most of the time, you're not going to change their opinion. You're not going to get them to come around and say, 9 times out of 10, they're not going to say, you know what? You're right. I'm sorry. Like, it's just not going to happen.
Yeah.
So, like, don't escalate the situation and try to de-escalate it, like you said, Matt. I really think, like, I don't even know if you meant, like, planned on saying that beforehand, but I think that, to me, is the biggest thing I got out of this whole thing. Like, and you didn't even say don't escalate. You just said try to de-escalate. I think it's just don't escalate and try to de-escalate it. I mean, don't fan the flames. That's all you can do, really, with haters.
It really is. Mm-hmm. So, you know, de-escalate. Sometimes de-escalating, like you said, just means removing them, blocking them, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, be professional. You know, that's the important thing. If at all possible on the front end, don't see them. I trust, you know, Kevin, who sees my emails before I ever do. I trust him to say, you know, that's just a hater. Like, you know, if somebody replies and says that email sucks, or you're a moron. Like, there's nothing I can do. Like, I can't even use that on social media.
Thanks for sharing that.
If you post the lengthy one, like, you know, Micah did, and you say, you know, you're super, like, you're, you know, you're bleepity bleepity bleep 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 scam. Like, it, again, it was so, it's, what's the word I'm looking for? It was so farcical that I was like, I can use that. You know, if all he had done is sent a message and said, your ad sucks. What are we supposed to do with that information?
Can I, Matt, request that we make shirts for Matt McWilliams Consulting that just say shove it up your alligator? I want that shirt.
Next conference, we're all wearing them.
Should it be a purple pickle going up the alligator?
It would be funny if it says shove it up your alligator and it's like a cartoon of an alligator with this face.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. Man. Please make that shirt. I would wear that shirt.
Yeah.
And I think there's a lot of other people that would too. I'm just saying, I think you could sell that. Quick poll in the comments. Would you wear a shirt that said, shove it up your alligator? Matt McWilliams Consulting.
What's going into the alligator?
It doesn't matter. I mean, that's kind of the point.
Micah's message. Wait, a rat's arm. A rat's arm.
A rat's arm.
Because I don't give a rat's arm about, or maybe it could be a copy of my super fun ad for my super fulfilling scam. That's
it. Would be fun. It would be fun if like the front was like a screenshot, quote unquote, of that message, and the back said, "Shove it up your alligator," with a picture of an alligator.
Oh,
that's funny.
All right. So
I want it, even if nobody else does.
And tactical sips and all kinds of stuff, and a little bit of fun. And
I feel like that should be the name of our weekly like Facebook Live series. Like, let's just name them all. Tactical sips and practical advice.
I like tactical sips and practical tips because you know
that works. Yeah.
Come on, Mark. Advice totally throws that off.
And alligators and rats' arms.
And with that, we're out of ideas.
Yep. All right, guys.
Now to go watch Chandler Lopez.
Now go shove it up your alligator. And enjoy the Chandler Lopez video. Mark, drop the link in the chat. Tell him we sent you. That's all for today. See you guys.
See you guys.